Hello, welcome. In today's video, we'll be teaching you how to set up Shad PS4, the PlayStation 4 emulator that has been surprising many people and generating a lot of clickbait, with claims of running Bloodborne at 300 FPS and that the game is already playable. But it's not quite like that, folks. I've also tested over 30 games, and I'll share my personal experience and show you some gameplay. To start the installation, the first step is to download the newest and most updated version of Shad PS4. To do this, you need to access the Shad PS4 GitHub, which can be easily found through Google, but I'll leave the link in the video description. It's important to have a GitHub account, as that's the only way you'll be able to access the files and download the latest version. After accessing the repository, go to the Actions tab and select the desired platform. For Windows, choose the Windows QD option. On this screen, you will see all the compiled versions. I recommend choosing a main version, as they are the most stable. Select a version with a green checkmark, which indicates it has been fully compiled. After selecting the version, click on the title, and on the next screen, just click on the generated artifact to download it. After downloading the artifact, extract the content into a folder of your choice. However, the emulator still won't work because it needs some dependencies. The easiest way to get these dependencies is by dumping them directly from a jailbroken PlayStation 4. Unfortunately, these files cannot be provided here, and currently it's difficult to find them online. For those who manage to get them, here's a tip. There are two versions circulating. One version contains only the essential files, and the other version includes all the dependencies, plus the 10.0 firmware. The versions with firmware are the most recommended. The Shad PS4 requirements mention that most tests were performed using the 11.0 firmware, which, unfortunately, I haven't found available yet. Once you have all the dependencies, paste them into the user folder, and then into the sys modules folder. After that, the emulator should open correctly. You will need to choose a folder where the emulator's game data will be saved. Just create any folder and configure the emulator to point to that folder. Installing your games is very simple. First, you need to acquire the games in PSN format, which means in PKG format. Then, go to the file menu and select Install PKG. Wait a few moments, and your games should be installed, appearing in the emulator's interface. Before you get too excited about finally playing PlayStation 4 games on your PC, there are a few things I need to mention that other influencers haven't covered yet. Almost all games have issues. Even if you manage to launch a game, memory leaks will occur, whether it's RAM or VRM. It doesn't matter if you're playing Bloodborne or Dead Cells, this will happen, making it nearly impossible to play for long periods. Having a large amount of RAM and VRM only delays the problem but doesn't prevent it. You can be sure of that. Another important point for those using controllers. The project currently doesn't support Zinput, only SDL. This means that you can't play with Microsoft controllers yet. I used the DualShock 4, which worked without any additional configuration. But as of now, vibration still isn't functional. In the emulator settings, there are a few options you can change, and most of them can cause the project to crash sooner than expected. For this reason, I recommend not changing the resolution. If you want to play in full screen, just check that option. The purpose of these tests was to see if my machine could run games with this project. I can already tell you that I didn't notice any performance issues, even using a 4-year-old processor. There was no bottleneck at all. Keep in mind that until the project becomes more optimized, hardware requirements will likely be higher. However, as the emulator evolves, less powerful devices should be able to run the games. From what I've noticed, the requirements are even lower than those for RPCS3. All games were captured at 720p in windowed mode, so I could monitor the log. Since the project is still in a very early stage, sometimes it's necessary to launch the game several times until it eventually reaches gameplay. So if you test it and it doesn't run the first time, try at least a few more times. The first game tested that reached gameplay was One Piece Burning Blood. Despite decent speed, there's a triangle on the left side of the screen, and characters are missing textures, making the gameplay impossible. On the other hand, the sound is running very well, and effects like dust and shaders aren't the issue in this game. The first Red Dead Redemption also reached gameplay, but with a speed inferior to the current solutions we have on the Switch, achieving a maximum performance of around 15 FPS. Additionally, the sound is completely broken, and there are various visual artifacts, like the absence of important objects in the scenery, such as buildings. The game flickers, and there are often issues with Bloom and the sky, forcing the player to look at the ground for objects to render again. Now, let's talk about Sonic Mania, a game that's practically the testing ground for any project. Unlike what we've seen with FPPS 4, where performance reached about 45 FPS, in ShadPS 4 we have smooth gameplay, with a steady 60 FPS both in the 2D stages and in the 3D bonus stages. Coming from this development team, which has been surprising everyone with each new update, it was expected that Sonic Mania would run flawlessly on ShadPS 4. In SteamWorld Dig 2, we also got excellent graphics with just a single visual issue. This game is a Metroidvania where you can dig into the ground in search of riches and new power-ups. When descending into areas lit by torches, the emulator presented an issue with the lighting, making the game brighter than usual. Other than that, the gameplay was perfect, with no crashes during the test. Toho Luna Knights is another 2D Metroidvania that heavily incorporates various elements and is well animated. I didn't detect any issues, whether visual or audio related. The game runs smoothly at a fixed 60 FPS. It seems that ShadPS 4 has already mastered most 2D games. Ultimate Marvel vs. Capcom 3, on the other hand, performed poorly. Ideally, this game should run at 60 FPS, but it only manages to reach 15 FPS. However, unlike other 3D games, there are no graphical issues or missing textures. As you can see, the game was utilizing about 40% of the GPU load, while the CPU was only using 35%. This clearly indicates that the problem lies in optimization, not a lack of hardware. And finally, we come to Bloodborne. I know there's a custom version that allows the game to run at a high frame rate, but I wanted to test it on the master version of ShadPS 4 and couldn't get past the menu screen. I've heard that there was previously an issue where a save file was needed for the emulator to get past this point, but I didn't look for it. The game's menus and other elements are already rendering very well, and the cutscene is perfect. However, in the master version, without any fixes, the game simply doesn't work. As you can see in the recording of Bloodborne disc, the game already has sound, but many textures are missing, and the colors are very dark. I've seen that many users are using reshade presets to make the game brighter and easier to see. One Piece Unlimited World was one of the first 3D games to run on ShadPS 4. I remember that the first time I reported this game going in-game, it had several missing textures and some vertex explosions. These issues have been completely fixed in newer versions, but the game is still not playable. It has random stutters every 3 or 4 seconds, completely pausing the gameplay. I believe this could be the first game on this system to become fully playable, and it seems like it won't be long before that happens. Chaos Code New Sign of Catastrophe is a 3D fighting game that also goes in-game. However, the game is still not in a playable state, as the menus have completely broken fonts, making it impossible to know exactly which mode you're selecting. This might change in an upcoming update, but for now, the experience is limited. The Kung Fu Panda game was a challenge. I tried running it several times, but it always freezes on the menu. From what I saw on Discord, many people have already managed to record gameplay of this game, but for me, at least, it hasn't been possible yet. Persona 5 Dancing in Starlight can render cutscenes in real time, albeit with some graphical issues. The overall speed is good, but the audio was completely missing. When I tried to start the gameplay to check if the audio would be fixed, the game froze on loading, making it impossible to test beyond the cutscenes. Shenmue 2, ported directly from the Dreamcast, runs very well on ShadPS 4. I noticed the absence of an NPC's face during a stroll around the city, but aside from this issue, the game ran satisfactorily, with expected speed and no severe audio or graphical problems. The highly acclaimed Resident Evil 4 is already running on ShadPS 4, but I couldn't get past the initial menu. It might require a specific save file to progress in the early moments. In any case, even in gameplay footage from other users, it still shows performance issues, reaching around 45 FPS depending on the user's PC, and isn't yet running at full speed. Another highly anticipated game is Dark Souls Remastered. Although the game initially renders perfectly, taking even a small step causes it to break completely. The character becomes distorted, movement is erratic, and trying to access other areas or climb stairs results in falling out of the scene into limbo. Despite these issues, I believe the game will be playable soon, as I managed to get almost 60 FPS fixed performance. BlazBlue Cross Tag Battle was a pleasant surprise in terms of emulation on ShadPS 4. Even though it's a 2D fighting game, it maintains solid performance on the emulator, even with more than two characters on screen simultaneously, and with many special effects. I played for a good amount of time without encountering crashes or significant visual problems, and the audio is also in great quality. Mitsurugi Kamui Haiki is a hack and slash set in small arenas where characters face hordes of enemies. Unfortunately, this game has been the most problematic so far. Almost the entire user interface font is broken, which greatly hinders gameplay. Additionally, the game's colors are rendered strangely, further affecting the experience. On the other hand, performance is solid, and the game would be playable if these defects were fixed. And if you want to see more game tests on Shad PS4, leave a comment. Remember that this emulator is still in a fully experimental stage and has a lot of room for improvement. If you like the video, don't forget to give it a like and share it in other emulation communities. And if this is your first time on the channel, subscribe for more updates every week. Thank you for your viewership, and see you in the next video.